Okay, I'm doing a video of gameplay for Warlords here. I'm going to try and keep this section to 10 minutes. We're just entering the 1920 year, so we have the cycle portion of the turn to do. Now this, the first part of that is negotiations segment and declarations segment. So the negotiation would normally take about 10-15 minutes at most, and at the end of it you'll declare any alliances that have been formed or broken or other things like that. I think there's going to be a change in this turn. At the moment we have Sun allied with Feng and Chang allied with Wu. What this means is that Chang and Wu were going to take out Feng and then turn on Sun. Now, Feng is being squeezed out, but Chang wants to take out Wu, and so Feng's going to be left out in the cold. And in fact, so and Sun doesn't fancy taking on a strong one of these two, so he's makes a deal. I just can just and I can say they make an agreement. So we have two alliances broken, which in this segment lose is each side two political points. So Chang and Sun both lose two political points, but then they form an alliance together that will gain them both one political point, and then I think necessarily Feng and Wu will have to join together, so they will each get one political point for that. So that's the end of the first diplomacy phase. Now we go to the famine phase, and we simply roll a d6. On a 6, there's no famine. This means there's one, and you draw a province chit. It says Guizhou, I think that's here. So that there was a famine there last turn, that stays for this year. So these other famine chits can come off. Then we go to the taxation segment. I've actually already counted that up. So after taxing and gaining a foreign aid first, after rolling for foreign aid and taxation, Chang stand at 38 in revenue, Feng at 13, Sun at 39, and Wu have 55. I might have made a mistake in there in the previous turn. In my records, but it's no problem for the sake of this demonstration game. Okay, although it might have been possible that because they were allied with Chang, and maybe they didn't spend so much the previous turn. Now we go to the maintenance segment, and I've actually, as I said, I calculated that. So each of these armies costs one revenue, so they've all paid for that, or else you could disband an army. Then we go to the bribe segment. So if any other para beyond the alliance agreements were made, such as may I move through your territory, we would be paying bribes for that now. And then forced production and deployment. I won't do that on camera, but essentially now what we do is, in the rules it says to do it on paper, but I'm using these numbers under each to determine the force is in my armies. Now an army can go up to 10 maximum. So for example, those two armies are at maximum force. This province otherwise is going to generate three revenue, and that will just go to the kitty. To the pot, and it will not be spent. So, using these chips to record, the Sun have spent, have used revenue in all of their provinces and brought their units up. They created some new armies, two new armies here. In fact, here they were able to create a new army and completely equip it up to maximum straight away. So what this means is that they have two armies here, three in here, two in here. They can move out, because if you don't leave a garrison behind in a province, you won't get the revenue for it. You could move out at the beginning of the year. You've got 4 monthly turns and come back, of course. Okay, so all the armies have been reinvigorated. Some areas did not use all of their revenue. You can't use the revenue in one area to pay for armies in another area. So that's saved and it's banked. So we end up with Chang has 10 revenue, Feng has 8, they were given 7 by Wu, Wu have 20, and Sun have 6. Now that's going to be important in the next operations phases, because you have to pay for armies that are beyond the forage value of each region, and if you want to move them. So we now go to the first operations turn. As an event phase, there's no empty regions, so we're not going to have a warlord arising. We've still got one warlord left here in Shanxi. It's quite difficult to get to. It's a penalty to attack it because of rough terrain, and it's only worth 2 revenue, so it's been avoided at the moment. It would help Chang in movement, but they haven't been taking advantage of that yet. They've been busy fighting down here. So now we go to the initiative phase, and we have to determine that. So Wu has the highest initiative, and Sun and Chang tie, and then Feng has the lowest. So that's initiative order, but because Wu's allied with Feng, they drop to theirs, and those two are allied together, so we're going to have the red, yellow, the Chang Sun faction against the Wu Feng faction in second initiative turn. And then we adjust the political values 1 towards 0 for each. And now we go to the first faction. So that is the alliance of red and yellow, the supply segment. So, for example, this region can only has forage for one, and there's 3 armies in there, so we have to pay 2 for that. That's fine. And then we also have to pay if we want to move an army. So they're going to be coming down here. That's a very strong region, so they'll pay for 1 army to move into there. 1, 2, and then we'll have this one. Move down to there. Could pay more to force march through that rough, but 1, 2, in fact, into here. 1, 2, so that's 3. Okay. Okay, so sort of pay 3. They have 3 left for the year, which is not a lot. I've been building up the armies too much, but we shall see. They have strength for another year's campaigning after, maybe. Okay, and Chang, they have to fight here, because this is actually controlled by Wu, although they were allies, so they're together in it, so pay 1 for him. And also they need to fight there. 1, 2, 3. And then they could do some movement around here, but they want to lose control. 2, 3, 4. They've only got 6 left for the year. Okay, and then we do the fighting. So what we have here is we have four against one. The attacker rolls, they get six, so that's 40% of four on the handy reckon chart here is 2 points off, and the roof right back with a two, which is 15% of one, which is nothing. So that army is destroyed and they do no damage to Chang. And because Wu lost against the one army, they lose 1 point. Chang won with a one army fight, and they, no, they didn't gain the province, that was theirs already. Okay, so they get one political point. And this fight here, okay, so that's going to be 16 against 10. The attacker first, I rolled a 2, so that's 15%. So that's 3 off 40% of 10 is, of course, 4. So that's 3 versus 4. So that's so two strong armies, that's how the defender wins. So I have to take 4 off here. You can choose which army they come off. I'll just take it off that one there. And then he loses 3. Down to 7. And the attackers have to go out. So I'll move them back like that. So they lost 2 army battles. That's minus 2. And Wu defended against the 2 army battle. Now, there's something missing from the rules, which is on the Farnay table. It's a random die roll, 1 to 6. Depending on the number of players, you get between 5 and 20 with 4 players, points of revenue. And apparently there should be modifiers, depending on your political points. But there's no correlation between the political points and the modifiers on this table. So, I mean, what it should mean is that because we were being got a high political points index, they should get more foreign aid generally, but that's not happening with that rule missing. Never mind, it's the same for all of them, although obviously it would help them at this point. So we've got another battle here. So we've got the attackers 20 points worth, they roll 2, so 15%, 20 points is determined as 3 versus 22. They weren't expecting to win this, they're just trying to try it the Wu down, which probably is not a good thing, not viable. Well, yes, it is possible because they could only bring up 9, even though they've got lots of money, there's only 9 they could put in that province at any point in terms of army factors. So anyway, they roll 10% of 22 is 2, and well, we were 2 on the attackers, weren't we, I think. So the attackers lose ties, so they fall back, having lost, both sides having lost 2 strength. Now, you might think, why not disband these armies? You've got 2 10 strength ones and 2 1 strength ones, because it costs 2 to bring an army on. So if I disbanded them and reduced those below down to 0, they would go. Oh, by the way, if you can read this, these zeros actually stand for 10. Should have mentioned that earlier. Okay, so that's the first alliances move. Now it's the Wu and the Feng. And Feng, they need to expand. They need to push Chang back. And their best chance is down here. So they're sending a 9 and a 3 down there. That's 2. I can get over the mountains just going that far. And another one from here, that's 3. And they're their allies, they don't need to defend this one, so they'll send 4, another one down to there. And another one here just in case. So that's 5 they spent just on movement. I think they needed to do that, organize things. And then we have their combat down here. So they have a total of 7 or 9, that's 16 factors. I rolled a 1, that's 10% bad luck. So 10% of 16 is determined as 2. And some, they also rolled 1, so 10% of 8 is only 1, so they actually win that. There's no penalty for coming over the hills into combat, but there would be if you're fighting in rough terrain. So they both lose 1. And Fang are victorious. They gain 1 province and beat 1 army. Okay, and some lose province, so they lose political point. Okay, and I could have been coordinating actions with their ally, couldn't I? But I hadn't. I think essentially, ally needs to take these out and take Chile. So yeah, I'm going to send in an attack here. 1, 2. Defensive maneuver 5, 6. So these tiny garrisons can garrison 7. So they're spending 7 on moving. They have 13 left, and now they've got a whopping 29 versus 20 there. They're on 6, so 40%. 29 is determined at 12. This is 30% of 26. Okay, 6. That's terrible for Chang. So they will have to retreat into here is their only option. And so Wu have gained, and they won against 2 armies, and Chang have lost a province. Okay, so that was good for the underdogs this turn. That's the end of the first operation turn. Then we go to the second, and it will be more of the same. Then we will go to the third, more of the same. And then the year will end, and we'll go back to the cycle where we have the diplomacy, the famine, and I forgot the revolt, didn't I? So after famine and before production, there should have been revolt, whereby I would just pull one of these, Ningxia, and there's just only ever one revolt, just in a random province, Ningxia, where is that? That's here. So you, that counts as like a 5-strength warlord. He fights the army there, and if they win, then the warlord will take this province and start building up their army, much like this warlord. But when the armies are this strong, the rebellion just causes a bit of damage to the army generally, so not to worry about that too much. I'll just take nominal. They're 5, you did 2, 15, and 1, yeah, so. And that's how it goes. So the second operations phase played out with some setbacks here and setbacks here. So Wu moved up here, had stunning victory, and Feng had stunning victory here, which brought them up to the top of the initiative, and they chose to go last now in this next third operations turn, in which not much can happen because Chang have only 4 revenue left, Feng have none, so they cannot move at all. In fact, they're going to lose an army here, seeing as they will not be able to support it with forage. Sun have 1, and Wu had a lot before, only have 11 revenue left. So in fact, the third operational turn just resulted in the loss of some armies for Chang and Feng, because they could not support them, and just a movement of one army by... Sorry, it was Sun and Feng, one army by Chang back here to support it in Liaoning. And that is the end of the 1920 turn. That is a turn of warlords. So that is the Game of Warlords. I just thought I'd say a bit about it. I'm just going to have a quick check if I'm in camera. Okay, yes, so it's a very nice fast-playing game. It's a shame that there's the errata that isn't there about the how the political points tie into the foreign aid. I've only played this first introduction scenario, so it could have a very different character when you have the communist forces and then the Japanese forces coming in. Some turns will play very quickly because people won't have much money, there won't be much movement, and consequently, no combat. The cycle turn within the sequence of play could take quite a long time. That's essentially the negotiation segment. So it is really tailored to be a simple game to play so that you can get into that negotiation and the diplomatic alliances, breaking alliances. You don't see too much of it in only with only four players, but with up to seven, obviously there could be a lot of potential for different combinations. Remembering you're only allowed to have two factions in each alliance. You cannot go further than that. So you couldn't have three ganging up on two and so forth. But you can have the informal alliance is in the sense of agreements which might be cemented by payments. And so I think this would be a really fun game to play in a group with some other fellows who you could have quite a long game going up to. How many years is that? What, 30, 34 years? That's 34 turns with three operational phases each turn. So that would be a whole day, maybe 2 days of play, depending on how quick you are with it. Otherwise, you can have these shorter scenarios that would just take an evening or an afternoon once you get going. There are a few ambiguities in the rules that I had to kind of just make my own notes on. Essentially, like the money and the force, the army strengths, it says to write it on paper. So I took that as essentially meaning that that is private information. It doesn't stipulate that such a thing, that is the case, but I think it would be important in a game such as this of simplicity that you need that kind of bluff capability to make that interesting. There's also, it doesn't stipulate because you gain political points for battles and gaining provinces, you can fight as alliances, so you can have two different forces in an alliance fighting an enemy in a province, and so as an alliance they could gain the province. It doesn't say whether you both gain the same amount of political points, or as an alliance you both lose the same amount of political points for losing a battle. So again, that was just something you would have to house rule, but I think that's the only two things that were I felt were missing. Oh, and then also, what happens if a player retreats into a warlord's region, or can you retreat into a region with a warlord? For example, if you lose a battle, you can't retreat into an enemy region, but an enemy faction says. But that, I don't know if that counts warlords or not. So, generally clear, and those are easily sort of cleared up, and you can figure it wouldn't hurt any one player, any one way, particularly it would affect all equally. So, as a solo play, it's an interesting as a study of what was going on. So, for example, it has focused my attention on what was actually happening from 1916. I knew about the communists and how they were fighting the Chiang Kai-shek, is that the KMT? Originally they had been all one sort of group. So Chiang Kai-shek became the strongest warlord at some point, but then with the invasions of the Japanese, which you could have then, so this game could have continued, and one of these factions would have become dominant, essentially would have won, but continuing the game, the Japanese would then come in, and then the communist factions would appear, or faction, and you'd have like a new power struggle with different factions. Some of these original factions might be tiny and ally either with the communists or with Chiang Kai-shek. So I don't know exactly that it would run out politically along correct political lines. I don't know if the communists allied with any other warlords, or if they just absorbed warlords into them. Those warlords had to, by default, become communists, as I suspect what actually happened. Chiang Kai-shek might have actually been the overall leader of a coalition of warlords, but of course in this game that could only be an alliance with one other faction. So it might go off the rails a bit historically speaking as the players play it out, but you know that's not a bad thing at all in the sense of the historicity of this game, because essentially the way I see it is that this game has brought my attention to what was going on at that time. It's involved me in the geography of the region, so if I did play out the Japanese invasion and then the communist uprisings and so forth, it would give me a good idea of military movements in big scale. So for example, you've got these mountains here and the rough terrain of Shanxi, that was completely left alone, and I could see people revolving around that and not really passing through it. Or if someone takes that as a central point, that's going to be a very strong fortress, relatively strong in this game, but a strong fortress in which to pass troops through down south or up north. And then, you know, you've got the northern regions, the southern regions, so the geography gives you an idea of how the conflict's played out, and also which ones, like these outlying regions have one revenue and one forage versus like 10 revenue and 3 forage. So Honan here in the centre can equip a whole army to its maximum and support two more armies every operations turn, whereas Singhai and these other ones, they can give you one point to an army and only support one army. So again, that will give you an idea, show you how the military conflicts would and had to pan out according to the geography and the capabilities of the region. And so that's very interesting in itself. But also just playing the game to give me an idea of this past history of China and to understand in a way that I could get from a book, but you know, this is a different way of doing it, and it could be more fun doing it with friends, to learn and to sort of have something to ponder for the rest of your life about where has China come from? You know, why is the Communist Party so strong? Is it because coming out of such a shambles and chaos relatively recently, they needed some strong structural strength to hold the nation together, and it's made it what it is today. So essentially what I'm just saying is that this is great because it's filled in a big gap of recentish, of modern history in my mind. You know, I knew about the Communist Party. I didn't really know where it came from. I knew about the struggle with Chiang Kai-shek, but I didn't really know where it came from, that it was the end of the dynastic realm in 1916 during the First World War. And that's what kick-started the modern Japan. And so this is that chaos that kick-starts it, and it's great to gain a part of that and gain an insight, even and with such a relatively simple game as this, you know, you can do that without having a big headache and getting stuck down into real nitty gritties. You just have the sweep of that struggle.